Okay, this slide showed the agenda for this presentation. Please, if I said anything which is not clear or not understandable because of my accent, please stop me and ask for clarification. So, what is the problem that we try to solve? Until recently, what we have is a bunch of organizations with their own data and usually incompatible systems. Different organizations in different countries have different ways to handle those data. This is very complex data, and sharing them is often very difficult. So we need a way to share the data on the web and to have a common language for querying the data. There is a real use case example from a coworker of mine. This guy worked on the propagation of cholera. The propagation of cholera depends on population density, on the migration, on city infrastructure, for example, the water supply, and copepod, because one propagation vector is the shrimp shell. The people who create and manage those data are quite different communities which are not used to work together. It's not common that oceanographers work with urbanists. So a guy who need to mix all those data for this study, we usually spend a lot of time trying to put those data together. The solution that we are looking for this problem is to create standard. This problem was big enough to encourage the creation of a consortium, the Open Geospatial Consortium. We called it OGC for the rest of the talk. OGC tried to create a world where anyone can benefit from the geospatial data. They are difficult to share. This is very complex. We will see later why. And there is a strong link for standard. Who is in the OGC? There is right now more than 400 people, organization or company. This is a non-profit organization. We see there where they come from. It's basically from everywhere around the world. The people from Asia are increasing. Years after years, we see this part increasing. There is commercial, university, research center. It's quite a mix of different kind of organization. OGC has a partnership with many organizations. This is just some of them, not all of them. Of particular interest is that one. Many OGC standards are joint standards between OGC and the ISO, International Organization for Standardization. So what OGC provide? OGC provide a document, PDF document, that define standard, often in as UML schema. They also provide XML schema. They are derived from UML, and they are available for free at the URL given there. There is an example, a small extract from a schema provided by OGC. And they provide tests for making sure that the software that we create is really OGC compliant. This is an example of UML from the OGC standard. This is what will be the main source of our work, the work that we are trying to do in Apache SIS. So starting with metadata. What are metadata? There is an example of data. If we see this image, what this image is showing, when those data are, can we trust those data? To which extent can we trust that? If we don't have no metadata, this kind of image of data are useless. What we are doing in SIS is not a general purpose metadata. There is other project for that. What we are doing is a very specific model. which is defined, again, a joint OGC ISO specification, which is defined by ISO 19115. This specification defines a very specific set of classes with attributes for defining how we identified the data, where it is, what is the content, is it temperature, salinity, a picture. Do I have the right to use those data? What are the constraints? How they are maintained, which frequency, update frequency, and stuff like that. So those metadata are implemented first, what OGC call implementation, actually, it's a Java interface, in a separated project, which is through API. I will talk a little bit about that later. And Apache is providing an implementation of the Java interface. The same word implementation is used for two different meanings here. For OGC, an implementation is to take a specification and translate that in a specific language, for example, Java. For us, it's Java interface. And for us, or for Java developer, implementation is to implement the Java interface. There is an example of what looks like a metadata. If we build a metadata from Apache SIS, using Apache SIS, and we just print that to the console, this is a very small extract of what it looks like. As I said, there is 100 of attributes. All those things, metadata, identification info, citation, title, and the structure is part of the ISO 19115 standard. So this is very precisely defined. And if you make a software for Europe, for example, if you plan to sell something to Europe, for every government in Europe, now it's the law. Every software have to produce metadata that look like that. They call that the Inspire initiative. So that was metadata. Now, a second part of SIS, it's referencing by coordinate. This is the problem of trying to set where on Earth is my coordinate. So a little bit of theory, just before to set what is in SIS. We have the Earth. This is a shape way too complicated for doing calculation on that. So we try to simplify this shape. The first step is to create what we call the geoid. Basically, geoid is a complex shape that is very close to the main sea level. This is not exactly the sea level. Actually, that would be the sea level if the sea was at rest. No current, no wind, just nothing move. That would be the geoid. Between the real Earth and the geoid, there is about 10 kilometers of difference. But the geoid is still too complicated for doing computation. We have to approximate that by an ellipsoid. There is a few hundred meters of difference between the geoid and the ellipsoid. And then when we need to show the data on a flat surface, a map or a screen, we have to accept some deformation because we cannot just take an ellipsoid and put that on a map. The deformation that we accept is what we call a map projection. There is many of that. The problem basically with map projection is because of the deformation, we can keep the angle, or we can keep the surface, but we cannot keep both. We have to choose what you want to keep, and usually depend on the kind of work that you want to do. So, talk about ellipsoid. Now, the problem is that there is many ellipsoid that may shift the Earth. It depends where you work. If someone live here, he can create an ellipsoid that fits very well his particular his region of the Earth, but it's a very bad match for the opposite side of the Earth. Or conversely, someone who lives here can have a very good match for his place, which is a bad match for the other place. It's also possible to have some compromise that is a reasonable match everywhere on the Earth. That's, for example, WGS 84. But it's not as good as a match done especially for one area. Another issue is that we have a lot of historical data that use all ellipsoid, and we need to be able to work with that. If we take the wrong ellipsoid, the error may be about 3 kilometers. So if you give a latitude and a longitude 40 degrees east, 20 degrees north, if you do not specify the datum or the ellipsoid, you may have 3 kilometers, up to 3 kilometers error. There is many datum. There is more than 400 datum in the APSG database. I will talk later a little bit more about APSG. So this is important. What I said was about datum. Now there is another concept, which is coordinate system. A coordinate system is something only mathematical. It's basically a set of axes. But in the context of geospatial, one thing to keep in mind is that the axis name are constrained. We cannot just take any name. For example, we never said latitude, we said geodetic latitude, because it's not the same than geocentric latitude or astronomical latitude. There is many latitudes. Between geodetic latitude and geocentric latitude, there is up to 20 kilometers of difference. So it's important to be specific. We have another issue is that our data may cross the dat line. So when we represent a rectangle, the area of interest for your study, in many cases, an easy case to represent the rectangle is to specify the lower corner and upper corner. But in the context of geospatial work, what we call lower corner is actually more the starting point. So starting point, ending point, and the longitude are increasing in the direction of positive value. In this case, what we would have called the lower corner is actually greater, the x value is greater than the upper corner. So it's not really minimum or maximum value, it's starting point, ending point. Apache SIS is designed for understanding this convention. So all functions like add, intersect, union, stuff like that, are able to understand this convention and compute the correct answer. I talked about datum. I talked about coordinate reference system. Coordinate reference system is only mathematical. Datum is related to a point on Earth. The combination of two is what we call a coordinate reference system. So a coordinate reference system is the mathematical concept of coordinate system fixed to the Earth with a datum, where we say this point is there. Sometimes there is really a material object that said where the datum is. There is many kind of coordinate reference system defined in the standard. They all relate to the kind of datum and coordinate system that we combine. I give here a few examples. For example, geodetic CRS is what we use most of the time. In the particular case where the geodetic CRS is combined with an ellipsoidal CS, I will not go into details, we get the latitude, longitude, the geographical latitude, longitude that we are used to hear about. And map projection are handled in a very special way. We'll skip that for now. Okay, I will not go into the details of this slide. What I want to show is only when we want to do a map projection or actually any kind of operation from one coordinate to another. It can be, for example, between two latitude and longitude. A latitude longitude in the in American US system that existed before WGS 84 to the one which is currently used with WGS 84. That's a kind of operation. That's basically the process that Apache SIS do. The only theoretical key element that I want to point out is that we have what we call a conversion, a coordinate conversion, and a coordinate transformation. That's not the same thing. What we call a coordinate conversion is a purely mathematical process. For example, if we do a map projection, if we go from latitude, longitude to Mercator, this is defined by mathematical formula. And this is as accurate as the floating point, computer floating point ALU. There is no theoretical limits to the accuracy. But if I change datum, as soon as we change datum, datum, as I said, is a very empirical work. There is different ellipsoid that try to match the Earth. In many kind, they are designed by people who went on the field, take measurement related to the Earth and put physical object on the Earth. Transformation from one to the other datum is a statistical process with error which has nothing to do with the mathematical accuracy. This is because it's empirical. It comes from measurement done on Earth, and there is an error related to that, like any kind of error we have when we make measurement. A transformation of an accuracy, it's maybe 1 meter. It's often 1 meter. It may be a few centimeters for the best one. North America datum shift, for example, has a few centimeter accuracy. Obviously, this is a lot of complexity. We try to hide that. So for the user, you could basically forget all the annoying stuff that I just said. Everything you need to do, you need to know the APG code of your referencing system. This is usually provided by the data provider. If the data provider very know well his data, he should be able to give to you the APG code that define this coordinate reference system. Just give this code to Apache SIS, and Apache SIS will fetch all the information that he need for doing the work from the APG database. Well, in Apache SIS 0.5, it's not completely finished. And in the same way, if you want to do a transformation from CRS A to CRS B, you can forget all the complexity about conversion, transformation. Just invoke one method with the two CRS and the area of interest. Because if you want to do a transformation between the same two CRS, you will not get the same thing for Texas than for another US state. There is just in USA, there is about 50 transformations between the two same CRS depending the area where you are. So if you provide this information to SIS, it will give you the right transformation for where you are. All those information come from the APG database. Now, another example of a thing which is not easy to handle. If you have your area of interest there and you want to express your area in another, in a map projection, this rectangle looks like that in a Lambert conformal projection. What we want usually is just a new rectangle which contains all the area of interest for simplicity. So this is what we call envelope transformation. The naive way is to say, okay, I take my four corners, I project those four corners and I get a new rectangle. If we do that, this is shown in this figure. So I take the four corners, this is the rectangle that I get, and we see that we are missing all this area. The easy way to fix that is to say, okay, I will take more points. So let's take point in the middle here. That's better. We have a better rectangle, but we are still missing a little bit of area. We could take more points. Some other projects are taking 400 points, more than 400 points. But it's still always an approximation. What SIS does? SIS have, or will have soon, a feature which is pretty much unique in geospatial project. I am not aware of any other project having that. SIS is able to project point, but also to give you the derivative of the transformation function at that point. What the derivative tell you? For example, if I transform this point, the derivative tell me, okay, if you go 1 degree east, this is the displacement, the move that you will have in number in your projection. If you move 1 degree north in geographic coordinate, this is what you get, the move that you get in the projection coordinate system. And those derivatives are different for every point on the map. What we can do with that, using, well, we know, for example, in numerical work, like the Newton iterative process, when you know the derivative, it allows the function to converge much faster. This is what we do with SIS. With the derivative information, we can compute a cubic curve, which is an approximation of the curve at this area, the light blue. Let's say that the real curve is the dark one, so we are still missing a little bit of area, but very often the maximum are at the same x coordinate. So it's having the equation of the approximation, it's very easy with just one line of code using derivative again to find where is the maximum and then to transform the point at this maximum. With this approach, with only a few points, with only 16 points, we tested that we get a more accurate answer than using 100 of points on the without derivative. This is for the two-dimensional case. For the two-dimensional case, it may seem nice, but not wonderful. But keep in mind that the same approach is used for 3, 4, 5, any number of dimensions, and the number of points, if you do not have derivative, the number of points that you need to iterate without derivative increase very, very, very fast with the number of dimensions. So the advantage is not so obvious in two-dimensional case. It becomes much more important in the three-dimensional case and huge in the four-dimensional or five-dimensional case. I will not go in details there, but the same idea can be used for raster reprojection, an image that we want to project in a new CRS. The simple case is to iterate, the simple approach is to iterate over every pixel and compute the projection for every pixel. This is very slow. Today, in computer are very efficient on a special kind of transformation, which is called affine transform. This is basically linear transformation. They have video card doing that, GPU doing that very, very well. So an efficient approach is to say, okay, I will take only the blue point. Is this part of the image close enough to a linear transformation? If it's close enough to a linear transformation, okay, I can give that to the GPU. It will do that very efficiently. If it's not close enough, then I will split again with the grid point to a smaller part of the image. Is this part linear? If not, we continue with the red point until we have small enough that we can say, okay, that's linear. We can transform that very efficiently. The problem with this approach is that the number of points that we need increase very fast with each iteration. There is much more green than blue, much more red than green. Approximately, we have each iteration requires 3 times more points than all previous iterations. So that's increased very fast, and this is a little bit frustrating when we think that the very last iteration, its only purpose was to say, oh, it was not necessary to do this iteration, I am linear. For example, if we add a green point, we compute the red point, and after computing the red point and comparing with what we will have, if we just computed a linear interpolation between the green point, we realized that the linear interpolation between the green point and the red point is close enough to a linear transformation. It's close enough. I have computed the green point for nothing. Using the derivative, it's possible to know in advance, before to perform the computation, if we are going to be close enough or not. So the derivative allows us to avoid the last iteration step, which allows us to use only one third of the point that we will need with our derivative. Again, like envelope, this is the two-dimensional case. One third, it's not huge, but in three, four, five dimensions, the difference increases very, very fast. Okay. Now we want to take the OGC standard and create Java interface for that. If we look for other projects on the web, what many projects does is to take the XML schema and to execute some tools like JaxB, for example. JaxB will convert the XML schema to a Java API. But if we do that, we get something which is hard to use for a Java developer. It's because the way they design the XML is not the way that we would design a Java API. In the metadata standard, they consistently duplicate every attribute. They use this pattern, consequently everywhere. So you see, for example, citation, responsible party, contact, online. This is defined like that in the standard. If you generate an API with JaxB from that, you get something, an API like that. This code is trying to get the URL of a metadata. get identification info, get citation, everything appear twice. There is also some complexity that comes from historic. In image, for example, we have the band that describes the image, but for historical reasons, when the first version of ISO specification went out, they didn't finish to define, to fully specify the band interface. So they complete the band interface in an ISO 19115-2. This is a kind of complexity that we can hide on the Java developer side by just merging those two interfaces in a single band interface. The referencing objects are not defined in exactly the same way in UML and in XML schema. I think that it's because in XML they wanted to enforce type safety in a way that they could not, because the constraints in XML are not the same than in Java. If we just compare the code, if you want to get the coordinate system of a CRS, on the left side, this is all the user need to write if you create the Java API from the UML. On the right side, this is what a user will need to write if you use an API generated from JaxB, for example, by JaxB from the XML schema. If you want to, just to explain why. Every single CRS is associated to exactly one coordinate system and one datum. But there is many kind of datum, and the kind of datum define the kind of CRS that we get. In the XML schema, for type safety, they did not put the datum property in the parent class. Instead, this datum is called vertical datum. They have a vertical datum property in vertical CRS, geodetic datum property in geodetic CRS. And they are doing the same thing for coordinate system. For coordinate system, it's still worst because there is many time of coordinate system. So they define three attributes, only one of the three, maybe not null. So a user of this API cannot just use get datum from the parent class where conceptually the datum exists. They have to check the actual subclass. And when you get the subclass, we have to check each of the three properties and to find which one returns a non-null value. Okay, this one summarizes why we do not use an automated process like JaxB or Eclipse from the XML schema. Why this needs to be done by hand. The conversion of UML to Java interface by hand is done in a JoAPI project. For now, it's Java, but future version could be other language. There is some people having done a Flex experimental project interface. It can be implemented by various projects, Apache SIS, ProjeFAR. We have wrapper for the ProjeFAR library, which is a library in C. This is an example of how we translate the UML to Java interface. We have defined a UML interface mostly for documentation purpose, which said exactly where in the UML is defined that element. So a developer can trace back where this particular GeoAPI element comes from. And we provide also test case. Those test cases are defined in the APG database, for example. So this comes from APG database. That's quite interesting because when we look at the test case in the library doing spatial referencing stuff, not all, but many test cases are actually anti-regression test case. They just run the software, they check the value that they get, and just make sure that we believe that this value is okay, and then just make sure that the software continues to produce the same value. It's better to have a data test from an external source. APG is providing that. And the interesting thing is that because the tests are provided by JoAPI, and JoAPI just use an interface for whatever implementation is behind, we can execute the same test on Apache SIS, on ProjeFAR, on whatever project implement the JoAPI interface. This increases the confidence that we can have in the test. If the test pass both ProjeFAR and Apache SIS and other library, there is good chance that the test is okay. So Apache SIS history. Apache SIS started 4 years ago as an alternative to LGPL library. And 2 years ago, we proposed to merge a code from Odol project to SIS. So this is the move that we are doing. This move is happening a little bit slowly because we try to review every interface to try to learn from history. We have done mistakes in the past. Probably I am still doing mistakes, I am sure. But we try to at least keep in mind the mistake that we have done in the past and fix at least those mistakes before it lands in the SIS. This means also we still have a pool of about 1 million of line of code remaining to port. Not all the million of line is worth porting. We will try to pick up just what is the best part of that million of line. But this includes most stuff and, up to map services, coverage services, many OGC web services. What we do not have in the 1 million of code that will need to be created in Apache SIS is tridimensional geometry. That's the OGC standard that we have right now, and some of the standard which is available in the pool of code that we can port. This is incomplete. We have many branches. We try to take advantage of latest Java development kit. So any contributor could take, work on the branch you want, and we can manage the merge. For myself, what I like to do is to work on the latest version, Java version, and then port to Udol version, because it helped me to at least planify or make the code ready for the next Java version. For example, I do not develop in the same way when I know that, this Java 8 has this new time stuff. So I can, if we develop on the Java 8 branch, we can take advantage of the new Java time stuff in Java. And for older version, we just try to do something that will simulate a little bit the Java time stuff. So what are the strong points of SIS? We try to hide the complexity about XML. What I have said earlier in the talk, where there is many elements in metadata which appear twice, this complexity is handled by JAXB adapter. So SIS, if we look at the code, SIS has a lot of JAXB adapter. It's because really the XML schema and the Java interface are not a one-to-one matching. But this allowed Java developer to hide this the way the XML were designed. The roadmap, we just released 1.4 yesterday, but this is a kind of intermediate release, because what I would said, I think would be the next major milestone would be 1.5 when we will have finished to port the referencing work. And the content of 0.6 will be discussed on the mailing list. We can either start geometry work or work on coverage faster, basically. We will see at that time what will be the priority. Issue that we have right now, EPHG is of critical importance to Apache SIS. Every competitor has the EPHG database. Not being allowed to distribute the EPHG database in SIS would be a major issue for SIS. EPHG conditions are very reasonable, I think, but there is two main points that we need to see if they can be accepted by Apache. The first is that first, EPHG is data, it's not software. We cannot reproduce the EPHG database. There is no way we can create an open source or Apache EPHG database. EPHG said that anyone can sell a product that contains EPHG, can do anything they want, but they cannot sell just EPHG alone. For Apache, what this means is that, this is not an issue as long as a user do not download Apache, delete everything until there is only EPHG database left, and sell that. If a user do that, we will be to be a violation of EPHG condition. But maybe my point of view is that if a user delete everything except EPHG, this is not the Apache project. There is nothing left from Apache there. So is it really an issue for Apache if this condition, if this restriction emerge? Another issue is that they put some condition, some very strict rule about what we do, what we can modify and when we cannot modify in EPHG database. And they said if you modify something that do not comply to the rule, that's okay, but do not call that EPHG. Apache is doing the same thing. If we read the condition of use in the Apache license, they said that if you fork an Apache software and you modify it, that's okay. But don't call that Apache whatever anymore. Use your own name. EPHG have the same restriction. And we can understand that because if you exchange your data with another other provider, and you said, okay, all my data, the referencing is APAG 4326. If it's not really that APAG, if you use something else, actually, it could be a matter of human life if your data is used in some critical transportation or stuff like that. It could be a matter of human life. Another issue is that we have a class name collision with another project, not Apache, but JPI on which we depend. There is an official release by OGC, but another project is using their own fork of OpenGIS interface. So if both projects are on the same virtual machine, we have a class name collision in the org OpenGIS package. But in this case, it's not Apache fault, since we used official release. And some link to what attack, some element that attack in this presentation. That's all. Is there any question? Yes? Yes. You mean the datum? That one? What we have done is to take, for example, the Lambert conformal formula, and we just make the analytic derivative. We took the formula and we compute the analytic derivative of those formula, and we implemented that in the code. Well, what some other project do is to, in this example, we take 3 points on the top and the bottom line. Some project take 40 points. Another project take 40 point top, 40 point bottom, 40 point right, 40 point on the left side. And it's still an approximation. The problem is that we don't know where the minimum is. So either we scan with a lot of points, or either we try to do something with derivative. Or the issue is to find where the maximum is. Okay. No other question? That's all. Thank you very much.